around the world with MS World. I'm Dr. Daniel Kantor here at ACTRIMS 2016. Besides talking about progressive multiple sclerosis here in New Orleans, we're also talking about other treatments for relapsing forms of multiple sclerosis. I'm standing in front of a poster that I'm actually part of, and that's my good friend, Dr. Jonathan Calkwood, who is the medical director of the Schapiro Center for MS at the Minneapolis Clinic in Minneapolis, Minnesota, to talk to us a little bit about what is Glatopa, what is glatiramer acetate, and what is Copaxone. Dr. Calkwood, many people with MS have at some time been on a drug called Copaxone. But recently, the FDA has approved the first generic, fully substitutable for glatiramer acetate 20 milligrams called Glatopa. What have you found in your patients who have gone to that medication?
Well, first of all, it's a relatively new occurrence. We're very excited to have generic drugs available. Pricing of drugs, cost of drugs, these all have impacts on patients daily, day in, day out. Adherence to therapy, being able to stay on treatment. So having a generic equivalent is at least exciting and encouraging that we may see some cost controls come into place and some adjustment of the cost of the drugs. However, with a generic, just like other generic drugs, sometimes they don't always work quite as well. So some of our confidence in whether a generic drug is going to be as effective, we need to build this over time. At this point, Glatopa hasn't had much of an impact. It's just now coming into the marketplace. Insurance companies are starting to adopt it. We're just beginning to see the first few patients getting on to Glatopa. And I can't really formulate any clinical experience. You know, it does really take quite a period of time to judge whether an MS treatment is effective. Small molecules, rather than more complex molecules like a medication like Glatopa or glatiramer acetate or Copaxone, are much harder to assess whether these treatments are effective. We can't do benchtop assays and see the biological effects in the immune system. In other words, is a generic going to have the same impact on preventing relapses, slowing disability, and preventing MRI changes that a trade Copaxone would? And that's somewhat of an open question.
So the answer about whether it works the same, we've at least looked at in animal models.
Yes.
And I think this poster actually covers that it looks equivalent in animal models. Mm-hmm. Now what's happening is human beings are getting it.
Correct.
What's interesting to me is that several years ago, there were several companies trying to make a generic glatiramer acetate, and none of those other companies have been able to release one. The only one that's been successful thus far is the one made right here in the old US of A.
Mm-hmm.
So, the medication that's made in the US of A, the Food and Drug Administration, FDA, has found it to be substitutable and to really be equivalent to it. What's also been interesting is that we have not had reports where people are saying, oh my God, a patient of mine switched from Copaxone and suddenly is doing much worse. But I do think more research is needed to look at that. So one of the things we're going to try to do, and I'm encouraging the manufacturers to do, is to look at what we call health economics outcome research, or HEOR, where we say, let's look at a big database, like an insurance database or a big practice database, and say, did we see more hospitalizations or ER visits when people switched? Thus far, it looks like no, but it'd be nice to actually do that research and to answer more questions.
I think that is a reasonable substitute for the data that we really want. What we really want, if at all possible, is head-to-head comparisons. If we're truly going to prove one drug is superior or equivalent or hopefully not inferior to another, a head-to-head comparison is the only way we're going to assess the biological impact of a drug. Does it really work? It can work in an animal model, but that animal model is not really MS. It can work in people, but we may not be able to demonstrate that with a short clinical trial. It may take several years, and a study like that would cost how many hundreds of millions of dollars would it cost to really do a trial comparison with large enough numbers over several years? So it's prohibitive. Data like that will at least support what we think is likely an equivalence based on studies like this one that show in animal models there is some equivalence in how genetics and the biology of MS comes into play.
I think you raise a good point. One of the goals of generics is to reduce the cost burden to individuals as well as to society.
The whole system.
If we start increasing the research burden, other things have to fall out of play. Either prices have to go up or we see less services. one of the nice things is we're still seeing those services. So I do think we have to figure out other ways of doing that research to make sure that we feel comfortable as well as our patients and you back home. So thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Calkwood, and thank you for joining us.